Assalamu alaikum. Welcome again to another ATP video. In this video, we'll be discussing sensory and motor pathways passing through the spinal cord. These pathways are also known as ascending and descending tracts respectively, which actually makes sense. Ascending, taking the information from the periphery passing through the spinal cord to the higher centers in the brain, thus sensory. While descending is bringing the information from the higher centers down to different segments of the spinal cord. So before talking about each ascending and descending pathway, let's have a closer look at the spinal cord. Here is a cross-section of the spinal cord, if you remember. We have gray matter and white matter. The gray matter is where cell bodies are located, while the white matter is where their axons are, making up the tracts. These axons are highly myelinated, thus the color is white. So during this video, we'll be focusing more on the white matter since we'll be discussing the tracts. Gray matter is divided mainly into anterior horn and posterior horn. The anterior horn has cell bodies or nuclei of motor neurons, whereas the posterior horn has the cell bodies of sensory neurons. Moreover, posterior horn is connected to the dorsal root ganglia. And to remind you, a ganglion is a cell body that's present outside the central nervous system. So to recap, we have gray and white matters for cell bodies and tracts respectively. We also have anterior and posterior horns of the gray matter, and the posterior horn is attached to the dorsal root ganglia. Also, when talking about sensory pathways, we usually discuss first, second, and sometimes third order neurons. The first order neuron is usually present in the dorsal root ganglia, which has its axons receiving a certain information from the periphery by a certain receptor or nerve ending. Let's follow the signal. If, let's say, somebody touches you, from a mechanical receptor present in your thumb, the chain will start from the first order neurons, which will then synapse with the second order neurons in the dorsal horn, which will carry the information then from the spinal cord to the thalamus, passing through brainstem, until it reaches the primary sensory cortex. Some tracts will also depend on the third order neurons to carry the information from the thalamus to even higher centers in the brain, which is the case in the example that we just provided. However, in descending or motor tracts, we usually consider upper motor neurons and lower motor neurons instead of first, second, and third order neurons. Upper motor neurons are the neurons traveling from higher motor centers of the brain till the anterior horn of the spinal cord or the nuclei of the cranial nerves. They synapse there, and then lower motor neurons arise from the same place to supply the end organ, which can be, for example, your biceps to help you carrying and enjoying your cup of tea. Now, injury to upper motor neuron will result in spastic paralysis because upper motor neuron has a net inhibitory effect. So if you lose upper motor neuron, you lose this effect and the result will be spastic type of paralysis. On the other hand, lower motor neuron injury will result in flaccid paralysis since biceps, like in our example, will not be getting electrical impulses anymore telling it to contract. Now with this solid background, let's start with the sensory tracts. We have six tracts on each side of the spinal cord, which are spinothalamic anterolateral system, dorsal column medial laminuscus system, spinocerebellar system, spinotectal tract, spino-olivary tract, and spinoreticular tract. One way to remember them is that all of them except one start with spino, since, as we mentioned, all of them carry the information from spinal cord up until the higher centers in the brain. Starting by spinothalamic or anterolateral system, it's important to note that this system consists of two tracts on each side of the spinal cord, anterior spinothalamic tract and lateral spinothalamic tract. The anterior spinothalamic tract carries crude touch and pressure sensations, whereas the lateral spinothalamic tract carries pain and temperature. So spinothalamic system in general carries two P's and two T's: pain, pressure, touch, and temperature. The two words located laterally are for the lateral spinothalamic. Since now we are discussing sensory tracts, we should be talking about first, second, and third order neurons, if you remember. So starting with the spinothalamic tract pathway, the pathway that we'll mention is for both anterior and lateral spinothalamic tracts. We have cell bodies of first-order neurons located in the dorsal root ganglia and receiving information from peripheral receptors and nerve endings for pain, temperature, crude touch, and pressure. First-order neurons will synapse with second-order neurons in the dorsal horn at the same level they enter. Then, the axons of the second-order neurons will cross, or decussate if you wish, to the contralateral side, or simply the opposite side of the spinal cord at the same level or a level above it, and ascend from there. Second-order neurons will reach the thalamus and synapse in the ventral posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus, from which the third-order neurons will arise, carrying the information to the final destination in the cerebral cortex. So let's say we are talking about pain. It will take this route, from the receptor till the dorsal root ganglia, and then it will go through second-order neuron to the contralateral side in the lateral spinothalamic tract until it reaches the VPL, or ventral posterolateral nucleus in the thalamus, and then the cerebral cortex. Now for clinical correlation, let's imagine a person has an injury to the left side of the spinal cord at the level of T4. What will happen to them? Try to pause the video and guess the answer. He or she will lose pain, temperature, crude touch, and pressure sensations on the right side of all parts of the body below T4. And also, he or she will lose all sensations from the left side of the body at the same level of T4 because the injury might affect the dorsal root ganglia or the dorsal horn of the spinal cord on the left side. So pause again and try to understand the following statement. Injury to right part of the spinal cord at the level of T7 will result in contralateral loss of pain, temperature, crude touch, and pressure sensations below T7, and ipsilateral loss of all sensations on the same side of T7. Contralateral in this example refers to the left side, while ipsilateral, which is the same side, is right side. Now let's move to the dorsal column laminuscus system. The system carries conscious proprioception, vibration, tactile sensation, and two-point discrimination. Again, it's composed of two tracts, one located medially, which is fasciculus gracilis, and it carries the information of the lower part of the body, so it's present throughout the spinal cord, and one located laterally, which is fasciculus cunatus, which carries information from the upper part of the body, and thus, it's not found on the lower part of the spinal cord below T5. You might want to relate fasciculus gracilis with gracilis muscle that's located on the medial side of the thigh to remember that fasciculus gracilis carries the information from the lower limbs. Now let's follow the route they take. Starting from a stimulus reaching first order neuron in the dorsal ganglia, here the axons of the first order neuron will ascend as is until they reach the lower part of the medulla. Fasciculus gracilis and cunatus will synapse there with the second order neurons in nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunatus respectively. The second order neuron in the medulla will then decussate or cross to the contralateral side until it reaches the VPL nucleus in the thalamus, or ventral posterolateral. From there it will synapse and a third order neuron will carry the information to higher centers in cerebral cortex. So here, if we have an injury to the spinal cord, the patient will have ipsilateral loss of two-point discrimination, vibration, and conscious proprioception below the level of the lesion. But if the injury is at the level of medulla or after the decussation, then the patient will suffer from loss of these sensations in the contralateral side. Our third tract in this video is spinocerebellar tract. This tract carries unconscious proprioception, and it has only two order neurons, since it does not ascend to the cerebral cortex and only reaches the cerebellum. It consists of ventral and dorsal spinocerebellar tracts. Both ventral and dorsal spinocerebellar tracts enter the spinal cord as first order neuron through dorsal root ganglia. Then, they will both synapse in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. The ventral tract will then decussate and ascend until it reaches the level of superior cerebellar peduncle, which is a connection between midbrain and the cerebellum. From there, it will enter the cerebellum, and it will decussate again to its original side in the cerebellum. On the other hand, the dorsal tract will synapse with second-order neurons in the dorsal horn, as we said, and then it will ascend on the same level without decussating, and will enter the cerebellum through the inferior cerebellar peduncle, which is again a connection between medulla and cerebellum, because it's the inferior one now. The fourth tract that we are going to discuss is spinotectal tract. This tract carries information to superior colliculus, an area present on the posterior part of the midbrain, and it regulates spinovisual reflexes. So let's say you felt that something is about to hit you, a ball for example. You immediately will move your head to see what's coming and then decide on a proper action to take. So this reflex is mediated by spinotectal, the sensory arm, and then tectospinal tract, part of the motor tracts. The fifth tract is spino-olivary tract. This tract carries information to inferior olivary nucleus, present in the medulla. It helps the cerebellum in coordination of movement to achieve balance. The sixth and last sensory tract is spinoreticular tract. This tract synapses with the reticular formation present within the brain stem. It plays a role in transmitting the signal of chronic or deep pain. And finally, we're done. We know it's a lot of details, but we hope this video made it a bit simpler. Please feel free to share with us your questions by commenting down below, and we will respond immediately, inshallah. And as always, don't forget to like and subscribe to receive our latest explanations.